We present The Wyndham Case by Jill Paton Walsh, dramatised for radio by Neville Teller, with Carolyn Pickles as Imogen Quy.
People speak of killing time, but sometimes the boot's on the other foot, and it's time that kills. Thinking back, I believe I can pinpoint the moment when death, concealed and cunning, first insinuated itself into St. Agatha's College, Cambridge. It was an evening in November 1999. Michaelmas term still had half its life to run. The same, alas, couldn't be said of poor Philip Skellow. A potential new benefactor, Lord Goldhooper, had suddenly appeared, offering the college some £5 million. And the master, Sir William Buckmoat, had invited a few people to dinner to entertain him. As college nurse, I had no real place at the table, but Lady B had begged me to balance the predominantly male guest list.
Imogen, dear, I'll be the only woman. Do please help me out.
Oh, yes, death was sly. Not one of us suspected the moment when, masked by the more or less idle chatter, he slid in amongst us.
But what is the Wyndham case, Master?
Would you believe me, Lord Goldhooper, if I told you it was a rather large and somewhat unusual bookcase?
Oh, isn't that rather misleading, William dear?
Nor, Master, does it do justice to one of St. Agatha's most respected traditions.
Oh, come off it, Crispin. I'm afraid, Lord Goldhooper, that Mr. Mountlessing must be considered somewhat biased. He holds the rather arcane and much too highly rewarded post of Wyndham Librarian.
Mr. Rumbold, on the other hand, is what might be termed St. Agatha's Common or Garden Librarian.
And I may add, much less richly remunerated.
I seem to have stirred up a hornet's nest, Master. I assure you I had no intention of doing...
A dispute hallowed by time, Lord Goldhooper. Indeed, 3 centuries. The Wyndham case is one of those rather embarrassing pieces of baggage from a bygone era that so many of our Cambridge colleges are encumbered with.
I'm afraid Lord Goldhooper will be getting a misleading impression of how much we welcome bequests to the college, and how scrupulous we are in carrying out the terms attached to them.
And that would never do, would it, Mr. Mountlessing, in view of the rather special conditions I'd attach to my own donation?
Actually, Lord Goldhooper, I was wondering if you include medicine among the subjects you'd prescribe under the terms of your bequest.
As our college nurse, Miss Quy would be considered to have a vested interest in medicine.
Quy? An unusual name?
Saxon, I believe. And from this part of the world. Quy's a village in East Anglia.
Well, Miss Quy, I'm afraid I class theoretical medicine along with all the other soft sciences, sociology, economics, and the rest of the tommy rot that passes for academic study these days. I want my 3 chairs and 9 scholarships to advance the sort of science capable of returning precise answers to precise questions. Physics, astronomy, inorganic chemistry.
In fact, Lord Goldhooper, your approach closely parallels Christopher Wyndham's. He was a Ptolemaic astronomer, and he also imposed certain conditions when he bequeathed St. Agatha's his unique library of works on that branch of science.
Perhaps I should explain that the Wyndham case was given to the college as a complete library, together with the rather magnificent oak bookcase that holds it. You must come and see it. It's 2 stories high, with steps at one end, and even a little gallery. Fortunately, we have a room large enough to contain it.
You said your benefactor imposed certain conditions.
Yes. Well, Wyndham lived to see the values he believed in being systematically destroyed. Isaac Newton's Principia was taking the world by storm, and the Ptolemaic system was in disrepute. Above everything, Wyndham wanted the body of knowledge that he'd gathered together to be preserved precisely as he left it.
So, he attached some of the strangest conditions to his bequest that you could imagine. For example, the Wyndham room is to be kept locked at all times, except when the librarian is present, which leads to rather restricted visiting hours, wouldn't you say, Crispin?
And then there's the system of audits.
Audits?
Yes. Oh. The complete library has to be audited within prescribed times to check that the contents are intact.
Oh, and don't forget the key.
Ah, yes, Lady P. Wyndham himself designed the lock, and there's only one key. I keep it on me at all times.
Ah, but there is a second key. It's held by the auditor, whoever he or she may be.
Let me explain. We don't know what arrangements Wyndham made for this audit. All we do know is that it's to be carried out once in every 100 years, but on a day chosen at random. If everything is in order, the college is to have a feast, paid for out of the bequest.
And if not?
Well, if ever any book is found to be missing, the college is to lose all benefit under the will. The whole bequest is to be disposed of. And since, as well as his library, Wyndham left us a great deal of property in and around Cambridge, its value today is almost incalculable. That would represent pretty near total financial ruin for the college.
But since St. Agatha's seems to be flourishing, I take it the audit has always turned up trumps. How many have there been?
Well, Christopher Wyndham died on the 8th of January, 1700. The first audit was carried out some 35 years later. There was a most splendid feast involving 5 dozen roast swans.
Then everyone seems to have forgotten all about it. So when the second audit took place, it caused more than a little surprise.
Yes, it was carried out just 100 years ago, in December 1899. The library was found to be complete, and there was another feast. Mm.
But that audit was out of time, surely. More than a century had elapsed since the last one.
No, Lord Goldhooper. The crucial timing stems from Wyndham's death, so an audit must occur within each successive 100 years, starting from the 8th of January, 1700.
Oh, goodness. William, dear, have you thought? It's now November 1999. That means there has to be an audit within the next 6 or 7 weeks.
What if the arrangements Wyndham made way back in 1700 have lapsed?
Well, let's hope they have, Miss Quy. That'd put an end to all this nonsense. No audit, and the terms of the bequest can be set aside. All the same, I don't think we should take any chances. I assume the Wyndham case is complete, Crispin?
I can assure you about that, Master.
But, Crispin, didn't you tell me you'd sent a few volumes away to be rebound? What if the auditor had turned up while they were gone? Oh. What if he turns up tomorrow?
Oh, my God! The binders had those volumes for nearly 6 months.
Oh, come, come, we mustn't bore our guest with this sort of thing. Lord Goldhooper, by tradition, we take port and dessert in the combination room on the other side of Fountain Court. Shall we make our way across?
No, I do not want the volumes to fall apart. But how long do they have to remain in the presses? How long? No, no, that'll never do. You must be quicker than that. Madam, I'm totally indifferent to the technicalities of your profession. All I can tell you is that we must have those 3 books back in St. Agatha's at the earliest possible moment. No, I expect you to deliver them here yourself.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've asked you to take a glass of sherry with me this morning for a very good reason, and it has nothing to do with the millennium. Those celebrations are behind us, I'm rather pleased to say, and we'll have to wait most of another 1,000 years before they're repeated. No, today is the 9th of January in the year of our Lord 2000. In other words, the 300th anniversary of Wyndham's death has come and gone, and I'm happy to report that no auditor has turned up to inspect the library. In short...
We hope you enjoyed this preview.
To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.